So we know that many people, when they approach LibreOffice, complain about the user interface. Of course, the issues that there are on the user interface are not really simple. LibreOffice was developed in quite a long time ago, and we still use the same engine for the user interface. So, of course, changing it completely according to what is considered the current trendy way of doing the user interface is not really easy. But on the other hand, users are educated or non-educated by what the large companies and especially Microsoft are doing. If you think that when Microsoft announced the Ribbon in 2007, they issued a license for the Ribbon, and the license for the Ribbon says that anyone can use the Ribbon for free, apart products that are competitive with the Microsoft products. So there is a number of software that for no reason, just because it was Microsoft, they switched to the Ribbon. The most, the best example is Foxit Reader. I don't know if you remember it. Is a reader for Windows, a PDF reader for Windows, rather good one. They kill themselves by switching to the Ribbon. So the product was a kind of several million users before switching to the Ribbon, and then it got to less than 1 million users after getting the Ribbon, because it, from a PDF reader doesn't do a lot of things. So it's just three or four menus with a very small number of options. They created the Ribbon, and what was available in the menu became almost unavailable. So people switched to other free PDF reader. And so they almost suicided themselves because they switched to the Ribbon. Which is the story of the Ribbon? The Ribbon is a marketing tool to convince users that the classic user interface, which is really ergonomic in the sense that every command is a couple of click away, is not ergonomic anymore. The reality is that you have to click more with the Ribbon than with the normal menus in most cases. And in the majority of cases, you have the same number of clicks, and in some cases, you have more clicks. The problem is that if you don't use commands, that was worse at first. They call it adaptive interface. So if you were not using a command, the command was going down in the layer. And I remember that Microsoft was used to give me a license of Office at the time. So I installed Office 2007 to do comparison, but of course I never printed a document. So after 6 months it was installed, printing, which is, I would say, not just a key feature for an Office suite, but it's one of the features that should be always first level, disappeared from my version. So I had to call my contact at Microsoft and tell him how to bring printing up again, because I needed to print a document. I said, this is so stupid that you give me a reason to tell people never use the Ribbon, because if after 6 months printing becomes unavailable in a software like Microsoft Office, this has not been studied in a proper way, because printing should be first level for everyone. I mean, you create a document for printing, and it was 2007. Today you can say, you create a document, you exchange a document digitally, but in 2007, 11 years ago, printing was still extremely popular. So this is real. I mean, this is really, it's in an email that you can find in the internet. So programming today is a race between software engineers striving to build bigger and better idiot-proof programs, and the universe trying to produce bigger and better, idiots. So far, the universe is winning. And I think it's true, because with the increase of the number of people that are using computers, it's not real idiots, it's people that is considering seeing the computer as a tool, and they do not even think when they have to use it. And my wife, for instance, is a very good example of this paradigm. She doesn't like using computer. She has to use the computer because, of course, this is something that you have to do. But when she doesn't find something, she's not looking around. She just say the program is not doing this. So the problem is education about people and so on. But anyway, this is, let's say, it's partially true. You can make a program idiot-proof, but then you will always find someone that doesn't like the program. And this is was for Aiko, but it's not here, but because it's working on the user interface. But it's if you have to explain it, it's not that good. But it, anyway, it's not really true. What many people do not know is that now we have a design blog, and we should promote it more because people in the design team are explaining in a very understandable way, which are the features. So the user perception, this is what I got. I do trainings on LibreOffice, and this is what I got from several users. And the in some cases you just show them, after a while you show them what happens and they say, yeah, but of course you can use it, but it's not as sexy as the other. I said, but do you want to use a program which is efficient or sexy? Because a program should be efficient. Sexiness in technology should not even exist as a way of judging things. The reality, so this is LibreOffice 3.3. This is LibreOffice 4, and it's very old. For us it's very old, because LibreOffice 4 is now, I think, 5 to 6 years ago. But you can already see the difference between 3 and 4. This is 5, and you can see again the difference. And this is not 6, because I forgot to... I was told that it was 16:9, while it's not 16:9. So I added the screenshot on the white one. But anyway, everyone knows the interface of LibreOffice 6.1 is completely different. And if you look at 3.3, they look like two different products. So in some cases, I show people the screenshot of LibreOffice 3.3, and side to side they realize how much the user interface has evolved and improved over time. New features, and some of them are very important. For instance, the new menus that we have in the three main modules. This is something which is very practical. It is true on one side that when you are doing training, anything new in the user interface forces you to retrain people. But on the other end, this is very convenient, because you can find immediately, especially sheeting calc, you have all the commands that are relevant for a spreadsheet in the same menu. So if you have a doubt, just go to that menu and you probably will find the command that you are looking for. And sliding impress is similar. Then, there was a new chart slide bar, redesign of color. This is nice, and I would say that if you compare this with Microsoft Office, even the last version, I don't know which is in which of the two you are able to choose the color in a more straightforward way. These are special characters. This is something that LibreOffice is way ahead of Microsoft Office. Because you can you open a dialog where you have all the characters, instead of looking for the character and getting the character. I mean, especially if you are not if you come from a like Franklin, from a image-based writing to a character-based writing, it's a lot more convenient to see all the characters instead of having to guess where the character might be in a dialogue windows. So now you have the recent one and the favorite ones. So I created, of course, in mine all the accepted letters which we can find in European languages, and now it's very straightforward to add a character, because in Italy we have only some accented letter. If I write in French, I need more. New icons. And I think that the new icons represent a very big improvement. It is true that the old version of LibreOffice are, let's say, old-fashioned icons. And still, now on Windows, the default is Colibre, but in the previous one was really, I would say, looking like the 70s and the 80s, so now it's a lot better. This is what Mohammed is doing. You can personalize the menu. This is something that many users do not consider and do not know. So you can really tweak the menu according to which are your preferences. And if you need something in the menu, you can add it. Now there is also, you see, before it was less straightforward. Now you have the classical editing image, so the wheel, and then you have the menu. It opens a contextual menu that allows you to open the different options. This is the notebook variants. We have talked about the notebook, of course I'm not being technical. I don't know how to judge it from the technical point of view. They tell that there are still bugs which are relevant to the notebook bar. But if you look at Writer, for instance, the notebook bar in Writer, all the different variants have been done and polished. There might be some issues in some bugs in when you call some commands, but this is a completely new look for LibreOffice, and it's similar to the concept of the ribbon. The reality is that you just group the icons that are on the toolbar according to logical groups, but there's no other real difference. When people say that the ribbon is not icon-based, this is not true. It is icon-based. The difference is that the icons are in a different position in comparison with the toolbar. And in some cases they are not, what you have, because under some icons in the ribbon you have the classical arrow. And for instance, under the table icon, you have not just a few options, you have a very long menu with all the options. And I'm sure that someone that is, which is the equivalent of the table menu in LibreOffice. So which is the difference between having an icon and a menu that says table and having exactly the same commands underneath? It's really something that when I see this kind of objections from people, I just think that they have never looked at the program in the right way. We have new gradients. This is a big advancement. Of course, it's for a niche of, for a small number or a niche number of people, but it's an improvement. This is Karasayaga. Unfortunately, the guy that designed this is Indonesian, could not attend because of visa issues. But he has produced a rather comprehensive set of icons, which is inspired by the old KDE icons. So, but this is complete, while the old KDE several holes in the icons. This is complete, and then we have Colibre, which is now the default on Windows. So let's say that LibreOffice, if you look it from another point of view, has advantages in the user interface. First, it's flexible. You can tweak the user interface. Many people don't know when I use the on every operating system I use the black icons, so the so-called cifre. I don't know if how to pronounce it in a different way. The icon set, because I short-sighted like every old people, and looking at contrasted icons doesn't ask for a lot of effort from my eyes. So I switched to the black and white icons, and people look at LibreOffice and say, "Oh, you, how can I have those icons?" And then I show the options, and I show that they can have not only black and white, but they can choose a different one. I said, "But no one has told me." And I said, "They are called preferences. So when you install a software, why you don't look into preferences to see if you have options that help you?" It's, I mean, a user should be curious about the software he's using, but this is not happening. Can we optimize for every screen size? This is very important. I mean, the machine I'm using now has a very small, especially vertically small screen size. But today you have 16:9, where the ribbon steals 1/4 or 1/3 of the screen. Why, if you use the small toolbar, you have a lot of vertical space to write the document, and you can use the sidebar for most command, and the sidebar doesn't steal anything because there is enough space between the sidebar and the other side of the screen for the document. So, and this is not possible with Microsoft Office. Even the latest Microsoft Office, which is being announced these days, I say that they copied the user interface from LibreOffice. Of course, I don't think they copied, but they realized that the vertical the management of vertical space was not optimal. So at the end, what the ribbon becomes a toolbar. So it's one line of icons, but they miss the sidebar. So they don't have the sidebar, because so you have all the commands on top, but you don't use the space on the right side, or on the left if you want to have it on the left. But I mean, they don't use the space in a good way. Why LibreOffice allows you to use the space in a good way?
It's planned for version 2020, I guess.
Yeah, they will do marketing about this.
New feature.
And you can customize according to user needs. For instance, in large companies, this is something that can be leveraged, but only a few people leverage it. So in a company, you can create a basic package where you change the menus with the commands that are used in that company, but no one is leveraging this. So you can, without creating a specific version, you can just personalize LibreOffice, and Ennio, I think, can provide you dozens of examples. He has thousands of LibreOffice users of different extraction, and of course he knows very well the program, so he changes the program according to the user. But the user would never do that. And of course, which is the advantage, is the help desk. So if the help desk hides command that can create issues, of course the help desk has less issues. Because if the user had to get to that command, he will call him and he will explain the feature, instead of having the user screwing up the document before he calls Ennio, because the document is screwed up, which is a lot worse than telling him before how to do the document. It's improving constantly. So every smaller version has improvement. The evolution is coherent, so you don't need to retrain people. When you have a new menu, you just tell people, you can send an email that says the new version will ask all the commands that are for styles in a menu. You don't have to explain again what styles are. And it's based on ergonomics, not on marketing. Of course, ergonomics are like document format, there's not a software that is perfect under the ergonomic point of view. Every software has some flaws in terms of ergonomics, because it has been developed in a different time, and of course the development path can influence positively or not the ergonomics. But anyway, it's not based on marketing, so we are not selling the user interface, we are designing the user interface. And this, I think, is very true. It's not what the software does, but it's what the user does. And in the user interface, this is extremely true. So I finished. If you have any question, otherwise.
Yeah, first is I noticed that Sandras is now active in this user interface development. Is he here?
Andreas Kainz?
Yeah.
No, he's not here.
No, he's not here.
Okay.
Mike, do you need the...
Let me set up the...
Because it's already connected, so you can just use mine.
And actually, the other one is that I use these bars, like bars, single bar and so on, mostly for testing, but somehow not permanently. And I know that it was in this expert configuration, right? Or not. Which version it will be? Or is it already enabled by default? It should be tested somehow, to test it more thoroughly.
So let's say that we would like, we have strongly expressed our marketing position to have it as final in 6.2, but it looks like there's still some development tweak to be applied. So I think that Heiko is discussing with development how to solve, because there are some bugs. I didn't find the bugs, but they say they are, so I trust them. And of course, if we release that as final, we should get rid of the major bugs. You can have a minor one, but major bugs have to be solved. We cannot have something that crashes the program on some machines or on, I don't use Windows, so of course I don't know what happens on Windows. I only use Macintosh and Linux, which are a lot more stable in this sense when you apply new features. So we hope to have it final for 6.2, but we will know that this when the first release candidate will be out, so around the end, I think end of November probably the first release candidate.
And one thing we really, really want to be sure about is making it easy to switch back to the regular interface.
Exactly.
We, doing the social media, we could, if loads of people try the notebook bar and then can't get back, they will be phoning us up, they will be phoning your house, they will find you, they'll visit our houses and then bam at the door and say, how do I get my damn interface back? So. That's something else we have to be very, very clear about.
You know what I didn't understand about that? Because not following closely the development, but they're just, let's say, by side, from some other issues. There are a lot of changes there. But I don't understand why they all go simultaneously, like everything. And notebook, and single bar, and this personal bar, whatever. I mean, it was not the logic to develop one fully, productionally, not experimentally, and then add others in the other version. So I'm afraid that by multiple choices we are postponing this decision, right?
I think it was because it was started by designers and not by developers. So designers looked at the visual appearance and not to the other issues that there are around development. Because a designer started feature.
Ah, Heiko.
Yeah, no, not Heiko. Let's say the group. But it's not developers that stumbled in afterwards. It was not a joint development, which is typical of open source. It's someone that is promoting his own, you know, his own view and then you solve the issues when they come. As again, the LibreOffice development is not based on marketing, so it's based on people that is developing features. So marketing tries to give an overall view about the development, but we cannot really say we would like to see this feature or that feature developed unless there is somebody that pays for the development of that feature. But if they are volunteer developed, that's the way they get developed.